Machtergreifung. It's the day that Hitler took power. He became chancellor on January 30th, 1933. So this is actually the day that we're talking about today, 90 years ago. Here you have Mr. Hitler in the circle of some of the members of his first cabinet after his appointment by President Paul von Hindenburg as Reich Chancellor. Note that Hitler, as well as the other members of his party, are wearing suits, not their party uniforms, as they normally would, in a sign of normalization, that they have arrived, that they have become civilized. Anything to do with the Nazis is always eerier if it's colorized, because it brings it that much closer. So here you have the same group of people, except now it is in color. And I want to just talk about who these people are, in case you don't recognize them. Do you recognize any of them? I wonder if I should turn off the light, see what happens.
Is that Winston Churchill?
Winston Churchill, yeah, of course. No, it isn't. Winston, they're all German.
Yes. Is that man over there Heisenberg?
Nope.
Heisenberg, yeah.
Hindenburg. Nope. Yeah.
On the left, Göring.
Yeah, Hermann Göring. This guy is Adolf Hitler. Oh, you knew him. Okay. Anybody else? Yeah.
The person on the right, isn't he the former chancellor?
No, you think it's Brüning, don't you? No, but actually, Papen was the leader of the cabinet. The president, yeah, that's him, that's von Papen. He's the vice chancellor. He's a nonpartisan reactionary who used to be a member of the Center Party. I have, for your convenience, labeled all these. Here you have Herr Hitler, NSDAP, chancellor. Here you have Göring, likewise. Göring was a war hero. He was an aviator, which is why he ended up being in charge of the Air Force. But he was also one of the more broad strategic thinkers. So he is painted in the West as this bumbling, overweight caricature, which is a gross understatement of the intelligence and evil that this man represents. So largely, the next couple of weeks when the regime is put in place, Göring is the architect of much of that repression and the driving force. Later on, when he gives policy speeches, it is very clear that he has a broad anti-communist vision, a global vision of Western Christian Aryan civilization, called to dominate the lesser races, and that it is a tragedy that the Western allies in this war have been so tainted by the Jews that they don't realize that this is their destiny. While he didn't get to live to see NATO being formed, he might have felt warm and fuzzy about that. Von Papen was a member of the Center Party. He, too, is a fanatical anti-communist. He's been fantasizing about a pan-European crusade against communism when he was chancellor as an appointee of Hindenburg under the emergency article, when they had these cabinets that governed without a parliamentary majority. Apparently, Stalin was terrified that he might actually succeed. He tried to put together an anti-Soviet coalition with France. The French he approached, however, leaked the plans and exposed it, so nothing came of it. Von Papen was, and if you read Benjamin Carter Head's book, you'll get to appreciate him in all his glory, a dumbass. And he was mostly famous for being an equestrian. I think he had won medals and so forth. He was an old noble, but he was so slow on the uptake that in front of a large audience of foreign press, I think it was Goebbels, made fun of him and sarcastically called him his best friend. And von Papen nearly cried with, he was so moved by this public display of affection. So many of, if anybody ever said, I had no idea that was going on, von Papen is one of the people you can actually believe sight unseen. Although of course the guilt he has, he was the one mainly, if you've heard said, we're going to domesticate Hitler. He is going to be our man to do the dirty work, but we're in charge. The old aristocracy that is so arrogant that they cannot possibly, they cannot imagine anybody possibly governing other than them. He is that guy. Next, Hugenberg, German National People's Party, the NVP. Hugenberg was basically the Rupert Murdoch of this age. He had the newspapers, or the William Randolph Hearst. He had the newspapers in Germany that had the mass circulation and that put out anti-Semitic, nationalist, belligerent, imperialist, pro-colonial, et cetera, anti-communist rhetoric, incitement, propaganda, day in, day out. He was one of the main architects of this alliance between the nationalists and Hitler's national socialists. And of course, the nationalists represented the barons of heavy industry, of agriculture, the old nobility, and so forth. So this was truly the party that represents the upper class. Von Blomberg has no party affiliation. He is a general. He represents the expertocracy, people who are nonpartisan experts, you know, because you want to send this signal that partisan strife is over. It's now all about the nation and whatnot. So he's a military man. And the military is tied into the regime from the start. Important to note, because after 1945, the military was quick to say that wasn't us. A, we were just following orders, and B, all the atrocities you might have heard about, and we're not so sure they actually happened, that wasn't us, that was the SS. But the military was always honorable, and we were in a just for Germany. Whereas, in fact, it was, of course, perfectly clear that they were part of this effort to build a nationalist, clerical, fascist, you know, dictatorship from the go. One of the first groups of people Hitler addressed when he had become chancellor was the officer corps, the highest ranking ones, on February 2nd. And in that meeting, he said, what we're going to have to do now is to root out Marxism, pacifism, and all these other ideologies that promote weakness. We need to strengthen the nation. We need to rebuild our economic power. But the way to do that is not through foreign trade, because there is a glut in the global market. That liberal answer that, you know, you just step up production and trade and that's how you're going to pull yourself out of a crisis. No. Military strength, conquest, and settler colonies in the East, where you have perfectly good land inhabited by people who are racially inferior and are not making use of. So we want the problem of unemployment and poverty in Germany solved by creating homesteaders, by creating like a vast landscape of German settler colonialism all the way to the Black Sea. And of course, if anybody thinks agriculture and the East, they think what landscape, what country? Yeah.
Ukraine.
Ukraine, exactly. Which had already been a client state at the very end of World War I. Under Ludendorff, who was leading some rampaging groups of the German army toward the end of the war, and as the Soviet Union was coming into place, and the Russian Tsar's empire and the Russian Republic were collapsing. So we probably need to go into more detail about this, especially about this plan, the settler colonialism, and how this was a selling point to the army, you know, They were already thinking in these terms. In World War I, their leaders, Ludendorff in particular, buddy of Hindenburg's and another German Nationalist People's Party representative, had thought in those terms. So where do you get that idea? Why, of course, no place other than the United States. That is like the primary thing. People would read Werner Zomba, the social democrat from the social sciences, who turns into a nationalist later on in life. He begins by saying, why is there no socialism in the United States? Why? Because they have the outlet of the frontier. The social question has a safety valve, which is the settlement. And of course, this is because you can take the land away from racially inferior groups, be it Native Americans or Mexicans. And then Zombard later on writes a book. What was the title of it again? It's basically why the Jew is to blame for capitalism. So he takes a sharp rightward turn, but he is a widely received author at the time. But that's not the only trajectory how the Nazis figure about settler colonialism. Consider also South Africa, a Dutch project, and then built on that model, Rhodesia, modern-day Zimbabwe, and Botswana. Both of them at one point known as Rhodesia, South and North Rhodesia. So there, if you look at the ads that run in British newspapers, even in the 1920s, it says low taxes, great farmland, cheap labor, cheap land. Go settle in Rhodesia. And so this is one of those societies where you have transplants, settlers, steeped in white supremacist ideology, who defend their racially segregated white supremacist regime until 1981. So that's another example. Australia is yet one more. Australia, if you look at racial segregation and racial ideology, in Australia, the Labour Party actually was the one who pursued the White Australia policy. In the words of a prime minister in the 1950s, two wrongs don't make a white. And this is also reflected in the treatment, of course, of native population right there. So settler colonialism is Hitler's pitch to the military. The military is on board with it. Here, Mr. Frick, National Socialist, he ends up being in charge of many parts of the administration that builds up the Nazi state. Also, he ends his career as the administrator for Bohemia and Moravia, what used to be the Czech Republic, and oversees, like in that function, he would be in charge very much toward the end, because you know that Bohemia remains under German army control at the time of capitulation. And then here, Baron Schwerin von Krosigk, not party affiliated, I would say colorful figure if he wasn't so bland, but his family history, actually, he goes back to like his great-great-grand aunt, I think, was married to Karl Marx. She was a Westphalian nobility. He is joining the party quietly in 1938, but doesn't make much of it. He remains in the cabinet all the way to the end. Like after Hitler kills himself, the final cabinet, he is he's still part of it. And his granddaughter is an actress who played a children's favorite character, a witch, in a series of movies dedicated to her adventure. So he's like almost so mainstream that you forget he's in the picture. Yeah.
I noticed those two, the other one's wearing blue suit.
Yes.
Do you think that would symbolize something?
I have no clue. I don't know that. Yeah. But if there is any symbolism intended, it goes over my head. So here you have the full group, and we're returning to the black and white because the Nazis should be, you know, not in color. It's too scary. And here you have more people. You see Göring, you see Goebbels next to Hitler. The toxic dwarf.
Which is a Germanic present. So you have them all assembled here. If you want, you can find the picture and identify them by name.
Many of them remain throughout. And oh, by the way, Schwerin von Krosigk, he was also in the Papen cabinet. So he's like the last minister out of an actual Weimar cabinet still alive at the end in office at the end of the war. This is, of course, another thing. Hitler's rise to power is not a coup. It's not a putsch. When he grabs power on January 30th of 1933, it is a lawful transition of power. The constitution of the Weimar Republic is never abolished. Much like Caesar rules in the name of the Senate and the people of Rome, so Hitler rules on the basis, formally speaking, of the Weimar Constitution all the way to the end. On the day that Hitler was appointed chancellor, the Nazi paramilitary and thugs in full formation and uniform marched through the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, carrying torches in a kind of ritual to inspire awe, to intimidate, to celebrate, singing patriotic and Nazi fight songs. And this sets the tone. On February 1st, Hindenburg dissolves the Reichstag, the parliament, which in itself is nothing especially nefarious. He wants the new government to govern with a parliamentary majority. So to call new elections allows the people to speak on that government. Do they support parties that will back that government? Elections are set for March 5th. So now there's going to be a short month of election campaigning. Immediately upon taking office, Göring places state police forces under his direct control. There is no federal police. However, it is important to note that the largest of the states, Prussia, has had their police removed under federal emergency orders from their control since, I want to say, 1932. They were already placed under a Reich minister's control, and now Göring takes direct control of the Prussian police. Because the land governments, especially Prussia has a social democratic prime minister. So the Prussian police would have been one armed body, a large group of people who might have stood in the way, and now the Nazis make them a tool of their own policies. The election campaign of the National Socialist German Workers' Party, NSDAP, is carried under the banner of the fight against Marxism. You saw the election poster I showed you. Marxism is the guardian angel of capitalism. That is one of those. Because there are protests, between February 2nd and 4th, the government issues decrees to outlaw protests, meetings, and publications, especially by communists. In spite of that, or rather because of that, on February 7th, 200,000 people rally in Berlin for a women's march wearing their pussy hats. I'm sorry, I mixed that up. For a large civil rights rally to protest these decrees and to voice their support for a democratic social and political order, the rule of law, and so forth. Outside of Berlin, there are many, many other of these kinds of protests. Across Germany, the Nazis violently suppress protests, meetings, and publications, spilling blood in dozens of places, committing murder, breaking skulls and bones of speakers who come out for election rallies and so forth, to the point where invited speakers cancel party leaders, like people who are at the level of, you know, AOC or possibly Nancy Pelosi will say, I'm not going there. I'm not going to out in public the last time some I went, I barely made it out alive because the police no longer protect our meetings and rallies. And to the extent that police do show up, they tend to protect the Nazi thugs that come to beat us up and spill our blood. One of the worst massacres was in Eisleben in Thuringia, where Nazis raided a communist meeting and killed several people. Overall, 69 individuals are murdered by Nazis during the election campaign and hundreds, if not thousands, injured, some severely. Already during this time, democratically elected representatives on the local level who are committed to democracy are picked up, interrogated, humiliated, injured, or killed by Nazi thugs, especially after, on February 23rd, Hermann Göring restructures the police and deputizes 50,000 men, all drawn from SS, SA, Stahlhelmbund, which is the German National People's Party group, to combat the radical left, especially the communist violence. They then go and commit acts of violence against anybody who is defending democracy. In all this, it is barely noticed, in part because the meeting is done in secret, that on February 20th, leaders of German industry, not just some of the leaders, but the leaders of German industry, meet with Nazi leaders and fork over 3 million Reichsmark to pay for the election campaign. So not just is the opposition intimidated, not just are their newspapers outlawed or fined, but also Nazi propaganda is financed by capital. And it gives the party a chance to just completely flood the public sphere with their propaganda. And of course, the propaganda is, we are the last thing standing between you and a communist dictatorship. They raid, police officially raid Communist Party headquarters on February 17th to search for coup plans that don't exist. There weren't any. And then on February 27th, by all accounts, what happens is a mentally disturbed Dutch anarchist, transient, sets fire to the parliament building, the Reichstag building. That building burns, and immediately the leadership blames this on the communists and says this was their signal to begin the uprising. Let's strike first. And on the next day, Hindenburg signs the decree to protect state and people, which abrogates constitutional rights and institutes far-ranging broad emergency powers. At this point, what you might consider a Bill of Rights is explicitly abandoned. So right of free speech, assembly, etc., fair trial, all these things, forget about it. In the interest of protecting state and people, we can just lock people up or preemptively, until further notice, kill them. So on that same day already, mass terror commences involving police, deputized thugs, those kinds of SA and SS thugs who didn't get to wear a badge. And between March 1st and 5th, leading authors, intellectuals, artists, union and party leaders on the left are arrested and placed in these wild concentration camps. On election day, to defend election integrity, combined patrols of official police to the left and SA watch over the polls. And the election outcome results in a growth of the vote share of the Nazi Party to 43.9%, which was considered a disappointing result because with all that repression, with all that propaganda, the very least you could expect is a clear majority. Now, of course, with the coalition partner, they have the majority
to back Hitler as chancellor with a clear majority of the votes in parliament. They have 52% together.
But they do not have the two-thirds majority needed to make constitutional changes. And they really want them. On the left, you have the communists who dip down to 12% at this point, and the social democrats who hold relatively steady at 18. The miscellaneous liberal parties, the German People's Party and the German Democratic Party, are down to 3%, and I think they have like 5 members in the final Reichstag. These are the parties that, in the first 5 years or so of the Weimar Republic, scored between 20 and 30%. So it's basically like the liberal middle class that abandoned democracy and took a headlong flight towards the National Socialist. The so-called milieu parties that are rooted in a specific ideological, professional, and religious group in the population that lives close together and has other social ties, clubs, church going, and so forth, are more or less impervious to the Nazi lure. The center party is the Catholic Party, and they were, of course, persecuted under Bismarck, and in the culture war of the empire, Catholics were marginalized, so they are more or less sticking to their guns, 14%, and this is the working class milieu, about 30% of organized union labor socialists and hangers-on, 30%. So what really switches, and then of course the classical nationalist upper crust, what really changes is the politics of the middle class, rural, Protestant, even big city shopkeepers, students, second tier lawyers, artists, journalists, ideology producers, white collar workers, etc., the professional classes, farmers, etc. They are the ones who flock to the Nazis. So the non-Catholic, non-socialist middle class. And yet, this would not be enough to really make radical changes that remain legal under the Constitution. So Hitler has work cut out for him. And the first thing he does, March 21st, is to signal to the conservatives that he wants a continuation, that he wants to reconnect to the glorious tradition of the Hohenzollern monarchy, William the First and Second, and the German Empire.
Cities prepare to rise from the ruins, greater than before.
This is unrelated.
In historic Garrison Church in Potsdam, where lie the bodies of Frederick the Great and his father, is once again the scene of imperial splendor as Field Marshal von Hindenburg and Chancellor Adolf Hitler arrive there to dedicate the new Reichstag. Cities prepared.
Did you recognize some of the marching tunes there?
Sounded like old school cartoons almost.
I know, right? That's, of course, it's always been ridiculous, but Prussia's Glory, that most recognizable tune there, da 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 da, That is like what you associate with the Hohenzollern monarchy. There are many people still alive at the time who remember the actual marches and parades that the emperor took part in. They had like what looked like live chickens on their heads, you know, with the helmets and so forth. But people were in awe. They loved, many people who were so inclined loved that display of power and glory and greatness. Now, for some, this was always ridiculous. There's a famous anarchist named Iluzminov who had a very infectious laugh and would stand there as these parades marched by and just laugh at them, ridicule them. And sometimes she would succeed in getting some of them to crack up, you know, miss a step or start laughing at themselves, because it is a ludicrous display of the abandonment of individual judgment, critical faculties, and so forth. So when the Reichstag assembles, they had their constitutive meeting in Potsdam. They moved back to an opera house in Berlin for the important vote on March 23rd for the Ermächtigungsgesetz, the Empowerment Act, which would have to pass with a two-thirds majority to give Hitler dictatorial powers and put the constitution on ice for the duration. Now, if you look at the numbers, it doesn't add up. The coalition has 53%, the governing coalition. Now, one thing they do almost right away with no legal basis whatsoever is to annul the communist mandates. Question?
Oh, no, I was just kind of gesturing what you were saying.
Yeah, so these are out of the picture, reducing the number to 566. It still just brings up Hitler's coalition to 60%. So what they want is, of course, to sway these 106 center party and liberal members. And how do they do that? In part because they say, we will not, with the center party, they say, we will not break up the Concordat, or we will sign a Concordat with the Pope. You will have your church autonomy and all that, with no danger to you. They make all kinds of promises. They say, we're really just a continuation here of the good old times. Also, if you don't vote for this, we will probably come and visit you at your home. Your wife and children may already be dead by the time you get there, just saying. So, but you make up your own mind. So in the end, the 26 Social Democrats didn't even get to vote because they were kept away by whatever reasons, like some were already arrested. 444 votes, that is almost everybody else, votes yes. So with 83%, these groups prevail. Hitler gets dictatorial powers. Of course, the SS armed and uniformed were in the room as the vote took place. They were jeering, they were pushing people, they were standing there breathing down their necks as that vote took place. The last Social Democrat to give a speech, there was Otto Wels.
Das Wort hat der Abgeordnete Wels. Meine Damen und Herren, der außenpolitischen Forderung deutscher Gleichberechtigung, die der Herr Reichskanzler erhoben hat, stimmen wir Sozialdemokraten umso nachdrücklicher zu, als wir sie bereits von jeher grundsätzlich verfochten haben.
This is the guy who is a dead man walking, who is the last Democratic representative who is speaking to an audience that is basically looking at their watches. When can we take this guy away? He knows this. What does he use this moment for? Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Reichskanzler, sir, your goal of getting Germany back to glory and greatness, to equal recognition on the international stage, is a great one. But we've already been for that all this time. Here are some examples of how I have personally fought when I had power in this republic to restore Germany to an equal place in the international scene. He ends this by saying, because you could achieve all your valuable and worthy goals by peaceful and constitutional means. Because it is possible to do so, you also have a duty to do so. There is no need for emergency measures. There is no need to end democracy. The Nazi response is, yeah, whatever, after the concentration camp with you, Marxist scum. This was the moment I knew that American liberalism would go down without a fight. On April 1st, 1933, Jewish businesses are boycotted by the party with the support of the government. On April 7th, the Civil Service Restoration Act is passed to remove Jews from any government positions, including government licensed ones like physicians. Here you have a doctor's office where the picture says it is forbidden to visit this doctor. He's a Jew. Now, of course, if you are Jewish, you can still go there, but you can't bill the public insurance that everybody relies on. So either he is not going to charge anything or you're going to have to pay out of pocket. Here we have a letter removing a medical school professor from his job as a teacher as well as a physician at the I'm thinking this is the Charité, like the university clinic in Berlin. Question.
What would the letter say generally?
It says that on the basis of paragraph 3 of the Civil Service Restoration Act dated April 3rd, 1933, I hereby revoke your permission to teach at the University of Berlin. This 14th September 1933, the Prussian Minister for Science, Art, and Popular Education. On May 10th, 1933, books are burned. And by the way, another round, and I haven't been able to find any documents on that, but another round of firings are women. Women who will receive letters reading something like, "To in accordance with the wishes of the new national government, we are giving your position to an unemployed, married German man." So the idea here is that another thing that is to be restored is the gender roles when it comes to the employment situation. Because the 1920s were a time where women, especially young women, were able to have an income of their own as typists, telegraph operators, telephone switchboard operators, secretaries, and so on and so forth. So in the end, as I already mentioned, June 30th, 1934, in the night of the Long Knives, many of the people who had helped Hitler into power, the conservatives, but even the quote unquote left wing, like the more proletarian wing of the Nazi party, were purged. And the ones that have like this innocuous little snatch next to their name, that's Hitler in pencil marking on this list what he wants off. So that's like the, yeah.
Why is it called the Night of the Long Knives?
That is a good question. And I don't know. Let me look that up. So that's all for today. Any other questions? You'll have another chance on Wednesday.
Doctor, is it?